fairly interesting. So please rise if you can. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I urge you in the sight of God, who gives life to all things, and before Christ Jesus, who witnessed the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep this commandment without spot, blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ's appearing, which he will manifest in his own time. He who is blessed and only Pontifate, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who alone has immortality, dwelling in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see, to whom be honor and everlasting power. Amen. Command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Let them do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to share, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. Thank you. You may be seated.
There's a guy you haven't seen for a while. Mike Poitras made it out to Men's Fellowship yesterday morning at the 10 o'clock hour, and we were delighted to have him, and took enough energy out of him that he couldn't make it here today. So that's the way his life goes in recovering from cancer. But so delighted, here we see him in one of his more expressive moments yesterday. And always invite any of you brothers, when you've got a time in your schedule on a Saturday morning, to stop on by. You don't have to feel obligated like you're either going to make it all the time or never make it, but it's when you can and the potential is there, there's usually a handful of us brothers there to interact, share, pray, catch up with one another, and enjoy the fellowship on Saturday morning. I also, before we move into the message, want to acknowledge the announcement that is written about in the bulletin about a youth ministry startup event this Thursday at the Carnegie House. It's at 6 o'clock and it's for parents or grandparents and teenagers, junior high or senior high. Marty and Christy and Mike Poitras are committed to being downstairs with the young people for some activity games like ping pong and foosball and air hockey. And the adults will be upstairs scheming, planning, figuring out, are we into this or are we able to be into this together to support it and to bring our youth to this. And of course, guess what? That also means that the youth will often be making decisions themselves about whether they're going to participate. But we figure if we don't give it a try, then it's never going to happen. But it is the desire of so many of you that I've heard supportive observations along the way since I put this in the bulletin over a month ago, that you are prayerfully supportive and encouraging about whatever we can do and try to do in terms of ministry for youth so that they can have a place to belong and feel that they are supportive of one another and that there is a spiritual reality that is a part of their joint experience that makes a difference now and in eternity. That being together, believers loving one another, youthful believers being together, or whether they're believing it or not, they're welcome to come and be a part of that experience. So that sounds like I was preaching an announcement, and I guess I was, but some something that's on my heart. And if you would join me just for a moment of prayer for that potential that God has, I would just have to say, He's laid it on my heart. That's a spiritual way of saying I can see that as a priority and we need to give it a try. So let's pray about this activity. Father, may your goodness surround us and may the glory and grace of Jesus Christ be evident in a ministry that is near and dear to your heart, as that your heart reaches out not only to the elderly and the saintly and the long gone before and still going at it folk, but the people that are finding their early pathway in this life. The junior hires and senior hires, whose parents and grandparents and great-grandparents want to share what they have come to appreciate with their family, to know the glory and goodness of God and the love of Jesus Christ, especially as it gets expressed one to another in a safe environment that we sometimes call a youth group. May it happen, Lord. Thy will be done. In Jesus' name, amen. In 1960, the Milton Bradley Company came out with a board game that the Carnegie family bought up quickly and began playing with zeal and enthusiasm. We had also cut our teeth already on Monopoly, and my dad was a real estate broker, and so business and life of getting in there and achieving your full potential was at the heart of the family in which I grew up. Now, that sounds like I'm painting them bad. There's some good in what I just said, but of course, you can make that everything in your life, and then suddenly the idea of having a responsible job and holding it down becomes your slave and master instead of a means to an end of glorifying the God who has saved us. The game of life, it had actually been invented 100 years before 1960, and it actually says in the small print on this game box that I took this picture of, it actually says that it's the 100th anniversary of this game, which it rightly is called in view of a game that came out in 1860 called the Checkered Game of Life. The print's a little too small to read any of that, but I'm just saying there was a game 100 years earlier, and it has places you can go called Honor and Cupid and Happiness and some bad places like Idleness and College. Oh, College would be good, maybe. Ambition could be a bad thing. Disgrace, interesting. Prison, I'm just reading some of the labels that someone playing this game might discover was a part of their game experience. And in 1960, you got the full color version with a pathway to move through life. And you either ended in the poor farm or on Millionaire Acres down at the bottom right. And, you know, there's a banker and all the money like in Monopoly, and so it is that you could be challenged to make something of your life, pretend in playing the game of life. Now here was the game of life's Bible that was written on the inside cover of the box top, and eventually someone even wrote a book called The Game of Life based upon the themes that are addressed in this particular game. Well, it's interesting, the lead line in The Game of Life, A True Game of Life, says on the board at the very top, at the left, if you probably can't read it, you too can be a millionaire in this game of life. That's the object of the game, a true-to-life game. Well, yes, game. Emphasize the word game, and, you know, we played it. We had fun playing it. You can... My purpose for bringing the game up is not to slam Milton Bradley. I had fun playing the game, but it is to raise some questions for us to think about what drives us, what is at the heart of our life. Is it simply to be a millionaire or a billionaire, I guess is what inflation has brought us to these days? The opportunity of getting married along the way as your car goes along the pathway and had children, little pigs in your backseat of your car. And then there's the reality of revenge. Later on in the 1978 edition, they changed the concept of revenge and made it a little more subtle. They called it sue for damages. And so the object, as I mentioned, was to arrive and live out your years in the green pastures of Millionaire Acres. If you are the first player to reach Millionaire Acres, you gain the following. Collect 100,000 bonus. Now, they describe that over the years, as they each decade, they come out with new additions, and they compensated for inflation, so you actually would have higher numbers. And they did away with, you know, the $500 bills and $1,000 bills. They eventually did away with those because they wanted you to feel like you're really playing with high stakes here. And sort of whet your appetite for the real life experience, I suppose. Winning the game. The player, this is the last line, the player with the most money wins the game. What are we after in this life? Very similar to the license plate that says, he who dies with the most toys wins. Yeah. You know, I'm a believer in Jesus Christ, but you know, I can sit here and feel guilty about the fact that I have a boat and I have a conservative size camper. But the question isn't what do you have and what don't you have? The question is whose are you? Who do you belong to? Who owns your heart? Who owns your life? Who runs and manages the issue, that which issues from your heart? So in 1 week, we talked about desiring to get behind Jesus and learn. You know, Peter, get behind me instead of confronting me up front. And we saw that in Mark 8:34. When he called people and disciples together and said, whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And then we talked about desiring something else, rescue by Jesus rather than self. And we recognize that the salvation in this call to discipleship is not the salvation to eternal life, but it is the call to deliverance and rescue from those things that we most naturally are inclined to do by nature and habit. So the salvation that Jesus spoke of in this passage about where we learn to lose our life for his sake in the Gospels is the life that requires a daily deliverance salvation or a rescue salvation that requires our participation. You know from what we've taught solidly that salvation from hell and eternal condemnation is a beautiful free gift, the grace of God made possible by the merits of Jesus Christ who gave himself for us as represented in the Lord's Supper. But the word salvation is broader, and it invites us to not only revel in the freeness of the secure gift that by which we belong to God eternally forever, apart from works, we are called into a life wherein God wants to rescue and deliver us from that which naturally grips and wants to own us. And that is the salvation of the life that Jesus spoke of. And the way to it is by desiring God's rescue, desiring rescue at the hands of Jesus in our daily walk. Today, as we come to the end of the passage that we have been studying through these last 3 or 4 weeks, we're going to, instead of talking about desiring some things like rescue and deliverance and experience following, we're going to say sometimes it's tempting to want what God can give us, like deliverance from our problems. Oh, get me out of this situation and I'll do this and that for you. But when it comes down, push comes to shove, what Jesus is calling us to is to desire Him. Desiring Jesus. And in Mark only, the phrase "and the gospel" is added to what we are invited to pursue, to base our life on a seeking for the honor of the name of Jesus, desiring to exalt Him in our lives, so that we might, in cooperation with His willing guidance and power, discover that we are co-laborers together with Him in the mission and ministry to those around us, and even to the deliverance of our own lives from destructive tendencies. A deliverance dependent on a heart-filled desire, not just for the deliverance, but for the deliverer Himself. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's sake will save it, will deliver our life from the corruption and ruin that sin can wreak havoc upon in our own experience as believers in Jesus who know we are eternally secure. A lot of stuff can get in the way if we don't first desire, and even last desire, first, second, and last, in every priority position, it is a desire for Jesus. For His sake, we are to lose our life, and for the gospel's sake, we are to lose our life, and in doing so, we will deliver ourselves from ourselves. I'd like to explore the idea of losing our life for the gospel. In Scripture, you have a reference to the gospel of God in Romans chapter 1, verse 1. It mentions the gospel of God. I think the gospel of God is what is first addressed in Genesis 3:15, and we won't do our study on that we've done a few times since I've been with you, but it is where the evil one will be given the opportunity to crush the heel, symbolism here, of the seed of the woman, but that the Savior, the seed of the woman, will crush the head of the evil one, Satan. It's figurative language for saying through mankind will come a redeemer, a savior, a deliverer who will not only bring life to that which has come under the condemnation of death by virtue of the sin of Adam, but he will bring abundance of life into that experience. And the gospel of God is broader than the message of how to get eternal life and be with Jesus forever. The gospel of God is essentially the compiled message of the whole Bible. Granted, it's hard to spot the message of God when you're reading through a lengthy genealogy, but there are ways of doing it, and that may not be the place to start to look for the gospel of God. But throughout the Psalms, for instance, in the Old Testament, you will find pictures and imagery, typology of the coming Redeemer, the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, and that is good news. Gospel means good news. The Bible is a book of good news. When we share with those who haven't heard it, can you start with good news instead of the bad news? To, I would call it, entice people to be interested enough to care of the fact that there is sin in their lives and that there needs to be a remedy for the death that sin has brought. Start with the good news, the gospel of God. Doesn't mean you start in Genesis 3:15 or Romans 1:1, where it mentions the gospel of God, because I think probably the best contact point is the gospel of the grace of God. Unless a person is Jewish, and they might more particularly be able to understand the gospel of the kingdom of God and then come to appreciate the gospel of the grace of God, all of which are spoken of in various portions of Scripture. Here are just a few references which we're not looking up today, but I'll say, well, at least you saw I had some references. You know, I'm not making these up. Okay. Gospel of the kingdom of God in Mark 1:15. And in Matthew 24:14, gospel of the grace of God, perhaps only mentioned by that phrase once in the scripture. If you know another, let me know. I didn't research that hard, but I knew about this verse in Paul's ministry to the Ephesian elders, Acts 20, verse 24. So are you willing to lose your life for Jesus' sake and the gospel's sake? A good message. The woman at the well considered who it was that was speaking to her and what it was he had to offer her. The goodness of Jesus and what he has to offer. Eternal, everlasting life to all who simply believe him for that gift. But Jesus calls us to a sacrificial discipleship life of losing our life rather than wasting our life. To lose your life is not, I believe, intended by Jesus here to be an expression of be a physical martyr, though that does happen in what may become more frequent in our knowing of what's going on in the world these days. But nonetheless, the emphasis is on what's up in your life's experience. Is it all centered around you and winning? Or is it centered around Jesus and the gospel? In verses 36 and verse 37, we've just been talking about verse 35, but in verse 36 and 37, at the bottom of the page, you will notice the English word soul in most of our translations. But it is important to me to bring to your attention, it is important to your understanding of this passage in order to understand that Jesus is speaking into your experience now, not just what's going to happen to you when you die. He's speaking into your experience now, and the same word in verse 35 that is translated life, save his life, will lose his life, will lose it, loses his life for it, and the gospel will save his life. With the pronoun, neuter pronoun, it. In verse 35, you have your life mentioned four times. Verse 36 mentions soul. Verse 37 mentions soul. And it is because of that translation that many people assume that we're talking about how to avoid hell or how not to sell your soul to the devil, meaning your eternal destiny. And so the issue of eternal destiny comes into our minds easily when we read about losing your soul. And Jesus is simply saying that there ought to be a resounding no to the question about your life's experience when you hear his two questions, one in verse 36, one in verse 37. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own life? It'll profit him nothing. Or what will a man give in exchange for his life? There's nothing you can give for it. Lose it for Jesus' sake. I guess from Frozen, are we supposed to say, let it go? Something like that. I don't know. So life and the translation soul, we're all talking about life. Your life includes the pursuit of pleasure, prosperity, and power. That's one way to live. Who says you can't take it with you? God's word pretty much says it. Listen to Jack Benny consider what he had to consider back from the days of radio. You know, he's known for being kind of a penny-pinching guy, and it was part of his comedy routine. So he was accosted on the streets one day by someone wanting to rob him.
Hey, bud. Bud. Huh? Got a match? Match? Yes, I have one right now. Make a move, Mr. Sticker. What? You hate me? Mister, put down that gun. Shut up. Now, come on. Your money or your life? Look, bud, I said your money or your life. I'm taking it over.
I hope today you're thinking it over. My friend David that I've been reading to you, I've got one more paragraph to read from his life, from his Facebook post from a month ago. And it pertains to the verses we've just been looking at. And he's this fellow that's been divorced and kept from his kids. And he writes, "You see, I used to think, now with a year's experience behind him after this tragedy, you see, I used to think that the measure of a man was all about what he had. It wasn't a thought that I entertained aloud or even consciously, but rather an attitude built over my life's worth of ignoring the issues that were going on in my heart and the lies that I was allowing to take up space there. When I allowed myself to take in those lies rather than shoo them away as I should have done, they gradually began to push out the things that I really should have been filling my heart with. Sometimes we grow through tragedy, sometimes we don't, and we become bitter and seek the path of revenge. You owe me, or I'm suing for damages, as David was sued for divorce. The last verse in our passage, verse 38, says this, "For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation of him, the Son of Man also will be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." And I think the way Jesus spoke these truths, repeating this motif about the life of a disciple three times, Matthew, and then Mark, and then in Luke, he contrasts the experience of desiring Jesus with the concept of being ashamed of Jesus in this world as we live, and of his words. Perhaps you can see the parallel desire of Jesus and the shame about Jesus. As he's saying, the issues are the same. For my sake, and in verse 38, it's of me, my sake. And then the gospel, and compared to my words. The word of God, the words of God, the message of the gospel spread throughout 66 books. This book is our lifeline. It's not contained on the backside of a cereal box or a game box or anything else like it was in the game of life. It's in life experiences recorded infallibly in the living and abiding word of God. In a parallel passage to verse 38 in the Matthew rendition, some additional words are recorded. All inspired, the writers chose which words to contain for their purposes in their gospel. But Matthew's rendition of the verse 38 concept about accountability when the day comes, Matthew 16:27, for the Son of Man will come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to his works. This verse in Matthew is one of the reasons, among the reasons I've already given, for why I am persuaded that Jesus is not talking about salvation unto eternal life in this whole passage's development. When there's a discussion of rewards, he is talking about the life of devotion and discipleship that we are to engage in. When he's talking about our death, spiritual death, and our need for life, he talks in terms of the free gift, the gift of everlasting life. And this passage is saying, what are you going to make, believer, of your life's experience? What will it count for when all is said and done? The game of life has a thing it calls the day of reckoning, but that happens in this life, in that game. And it's poor farm or millionaire acres, as though there's nothing beyond it. Just the way a secular game would do. So my question to you today is, do you desire Jesus? Do you desire, you have some, can you cultivate some feelings and ask him to help you see clearly the truth of the gospel? I usually find my feelings respond to ideas and thoughts, not just direct emotional boost. And so I read the word, and I prayerfully read the word that I might enter into it fully and not just intellectually. Do you desire Jesus and his word, his message? Or are you shy and ashamed and doing life your way, like Frank Sinatra did? Sadness when I hear this. I'll see if I can back it up. And Elizabeth, do we have some audio?
Love, I've laughed and cried. I've had my fill, my share of losing. And now, as tears subside, did all that,
can say, I did it Jesus' way. I got behind Jesus. Certainly we are not canceling out the reality of our participation in the will and work of God, but we are saying, when it all said and done, did you do it His way? Or did you stand in front of Him like Peter did momentarily and need to get behind and follow? Are you desiring Jesus and the gospel without shame? Father, thank you for your words through your Son, the Lord Jesus, because you didn't just leave us to wait until you came back, but you gave us the gift of life, and now you showed us how to live it. May our values be transformed by the presence of the Spirit and the Word of God. May we love you with all our hearts, and may we love your gospel, your words, your message. In Jesus' name, amen. Our closing song is Take My Life and Let It Be. It doesn't mean take my life and let it be what I want it to be. You'll hear the words of the song and you'll know it's talking about being devoted followers of Jesus. If you want the hymn book, it's 380. And let's stand if you can and sing our closing song.
Versus on TV.
Yeah.